so much bigger. It opened
Yo,
my eyes up for
Life,
so many things.
Dave Life Show.
But I'm not going to say I wasn't hurt. Like,
conversation
I was, like, I wish it didn't happen. I'm glad that some of it did, but I wish it didn't happen, but I was hurt. So I definitely understand where you were at from West New York. Feeling it, and then obviously what happened in Houston within in 10 games, which was fucking crazy. So we both definitely understand what it feels like from this game to be here at the top. Like, we was at the top of this game, and then at some point, you know, people acting like they don't really respect or what you have meant to the organization. Like, that shit hurt, bro. You know what I mean?
Because we live in a society where everything is instantaneous. Like, it's on to the next so quick, right? It's you just think about it. It's like we program to that because we play 82 games a year. We play every other night or sometimes back to back. So it's like, we lose a game, it's like, oh, you don't have time to be mad about that game. You got to move on to the next thing. So we always programmed like that. So right. When we have a chance to sit still and really think about it, that's where things start to make sense. We start putting things in place. We start prioritizing. We start prioritizing people. We start prioritizing life. What's important to us, what's not important to us. At the end of the day, this game is just a game at the end of the day. We've been doing it for a long time. We put a lot of work into who we are today. It's not people just see highlights. Now everybody just see highlights. So they judge you off of highlights. If you ain't doing something on the highlight, it's over. Nobody's watching full games no more. For example, like NBA now is playing old games. They replaying games. So I'm sitting down with my son the other day, and I forgot what game we was watching. And he's just like, oh, Dad, that's so-and-so. Oh, I seen that highlight. I'm like, yeah, you saw the highlight. Now you get to see the game. Now you get to see what happened in the highlight. Then he was like, yo, now that highlight don't even mean that much to me no more.
Right.
And I'm like, why you say that? He was like, because I'm actually seeing the lead up to the actual highlight.
Ooh.
So I'm like, you know what I'm saying? So this is the knowledge that we're kicking to each other. And I'm like, oh, so now you understand what these highlights would do to you. Don't be that guy.
You about to play a team, you know, that week, and they give you like the highlights of each player on the team. Every player on that team looked like an all-star. Or every
Man,
team.
That's a film session. That's a film session for you.
No, they make every team look like the Bulls, you know what I'm saying? The 72-10 Bulls. They make every player look like an all-star.
Yeah.
And that's what highlights do.
Man, highlights is the most beautiful thing and the most dangerous thing at the end of the day because I've sat even with my son, like, you know, I'm more into the kids now and AAU and all of that, so I'm seeing, like, we always go back and forth with the highlights, who's doing this, and I'll be like, I want to see the game, like, let me go watch a game. So when I go to these tournaments, he's like, oh, why you want to watch that game? I'm like, I'm watching it from a different perspective.
Right.
I want to see what your highlight reel is talking about. Right. Right. So I get the game today, and I support all the highlights because that's where we at. And people love highlights. Like, everybody love highlights. We love highlights. We love to watch our own highlights. But when you talking about,
are you watching? Are you going on YouTube and watching your own highlights right now?
No, I haven't watched my highlights. I haven't watched my highlights in a while. My son will send me highlights. Lyle will send me highlights. Like, she's on it all day. She'll send you a game. She'll send you a game from 2006, January 1st, January 2nd. Like, she'll send you some shit like that. I'm like, yo, where you find this game at?
Hey, yo, let's shift back into basketball real quick because we would both be remiss if we would not talk about this human being. Talk to me about, and I will do the same thing, talk to me about one of your favorite Kobe moments, dog. And some, you know, obviously people have asked us about this, but between me and you, obviously both of us having a close relationship from the standpoint of basketball and off the court with 2-4. But talk to me about our guy and like one of the dope moments that you always go back to when you think about it.
It's. I mean, it's so many. I just remember the first time, not the first time, but I felt like I gained his respect because we playing. I'm in Denver, he's in LA, and obviously, but I'm playing, and I come on the court. So, you know, you come on the court, that's why it's like it's hard to speak to people when they come on the court, because you don't know what their mentality is. They might dub you, right? They might not even say nothing to you. They might not shake your hand. So,
right.
Gold comes on the court, gives me dab, I give him dab. So throughout the game, he's like saying little shit to me, like, "Oh yeah, now we gonna let you go off right now until the fourth quarter. I'm gonna guard you in the fourth quarter." And I'm like, "Get the fuck, what? Get out! You gonna guard me? Why you don't guard me now?" He's like, "Nah. I'm not here to stop you. We here to stop you." So when you young and hear that, you be like, "Oh, like what is it? What is he talking about? I'm about to get buckets." So the game went on. The game goes on, and fourth quarter comes. I mean, he's getting every call. He's fouling. He's not calling shit. And he's just like, "Yo, I told you what's about to happen." And I'm like, what's happening? He's like, "All right, let's go. Let's give the world what they want to see." I offensive rebound. He fouling me, grabbing me. He come down. I foul him hard. I come back down. He foul me hard. We just talking. We talking trash. I have my braids then. The most disrespectful shit anybody can do is touch your braids. Like, if somebody got a tech, I don't know if it was me or somebody, I got a tech, and we at half court, he like hit the bottom of my braids, like
on purpose, like just smack,
like the yeah, just like calm down little bro, like that. he little bro me, like he sun me right there. I'm just like, "I'm gonna kill this, like you don't touch my braids." So then from that point on, it was just like after the game, he came to me, he was just like, "You got my respect." And I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, what? We got to play for your respect? Like, at this time, I don't know. Like, I got to play for your respect? No, I'm trying to come out here and go and tear you apart.
Right.
And he's like, "Nah, like, you know, you didn't back down. Like, you went hard. Like, I'm even hurting right now. Like, yo, my chest hurt, my body hurt. Boom, boom, boom. Like, all right, I wasn't, you know, I wanted to see if you was going to stand the test of time." I said, "Oh, this motherfucker on some Corleone shit over here. Like, he's the Godfather over here. I got to kiss the ring." That's what I was thinking. Like, that's, but for him to like almost crown me at that point in time, like, you know what I mean? Like, he donned me, like, "Oh, okay, here, you good. You good in the book, in the book of, you know," and he was eight at the time. You good in the book of eight.
Right.
And so ever since then, we became close, talking. And then similar to us, it was just more, it was all basketball. Then over the years, it became about friendship. Then it became about family. Then it just became about just life in general.
Right.
So that's like, that's my story of like, didn't know I was being tested by him. But being tested and like passing the test without you even knowing it.
What year was it in the playoffs versus each other? Because y'all was battling, bro.
That was the Western Conference Finals in I think that was 2009. I think it was 2009.
That year, right?
Huh?
Did they win a championship that year?
Yeah, so I was sick because we were supposed to beat them that year.
Bro,
I don't like saying all that, but when you reevaluate everything, we really wanted Orlando in that finals that year. Like, we was like, if we get game one in L.A. or game two, we going back to Denver. We sweeping them. Like, we was going to beat them that year. If we'd have won in L.A. If we'd have won both games, we would have beat them.
Right.
And we'd have swept Orlando that year. Like, it was just like.
No, Orlando was all right, but they won.
We'd have swept them. We'd have swept them that year.
All right, let me see. I got so many favorite Kobe moments that I told so many. But I think, like, right away, the media put me and Kobe versus each other.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
It was about Shaq's sidekick, right? Who's going to be the best sidekick in Shaq? So immediately, me and Kobe. Now, you got to let's go back. My favorite players was Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, and Allen Iverson.
Right.
So I come into the NBA, and like we all do, I'm like, "Shit, I'm playing against him. This is my dude." Like, me and my brother's been loving Kobe for so long, right? And then year two, now me and Kobe got to, like, do like this. Because now I got shot. So now we not talking to each other, nothing. Like, I want to hello, or I want to tell him, like, yo, you my favorite player or something, right? But I don't get a chance to do that. And immediately, we got to start, like, battling versus each other. And I just remember, like, when I first played against Kobe, because when I first came in, I was never a shooter. When I first Kobe treated me like guys treat Ben Simmons right now. Like, he went so far under the screen that I had to earn his respect by knocking shots down, right? So I remember us playing on Christmas, when Shaq came my second year, and Kobe going so far on the screen, and I just kept like, pow, pow, pow. And Kobe walked up to me at some point in the game. He said, oh, you've been working. Oh, you've been working on your game, right? So, you know me, I ain't have many words for him. I just shook my head like, you better respect me type shit. And I remember at some point in the game, I grabbed the ball. And Kobe, as soon as I grabbed the ball, he up 94 feet. And at that moment, I was like, I got it.
Yeah.
This is somebody who was going under five screens to let me shoot.
And he ain't doing that with everybody. He wasn't doing that with everybody.
Feet. And like, you know, when Kobe picks up 94 feet, like, he's a great defender. But that was respect.
Right. No, it was a chess game with him.
It was a chess game with him. So when
it was a chess game.
I was like, okay, now I got the respect of my favorite player. Now let's go. And from that point on, dog, we just kept having battles until we all got in the Olympics in 08, and we all got a chance to really, really get a chance to see each other work and really get to know each other outside of basketball.
Yeah. I mean, like, when you're around somebody for, 30 days, 30 plus days, in a whole nother country, like, and then y'all on the same team, like, only two things can happen. It's not gonna work. Y'all not gonna like each other. You're gonna find something wrong with this guy, or y'all gonna become very close.
Right. Yeah, dog. So, like, I think we all grew a different, because the thing, what I tell people all the time, is we did not fuck with a lot of people in the NBA.
That's a Snapple fact. Like, that's a Snapple fact right there.
And I think for all of us, when we got to the Olympics, like, he was that dude who we would, like, we heard stories about Kobe, right? We heard that he got up and we worked out at 2 a.m, or, you know, he did this and that. But we believed him. And to the Olympics, and I start seeing this dude work, and I'm like, oh, he's a freak. He on his second. We were hating the fuck, too.
Nicole, he was just different, man. And I think like that mentality was totally different. Like, his mentality was different. Like, for us to have a chance to go to Olympics with him and be there with him and just, like, you know, build something different.
Right.
Like, we would always cherish that. Like, we will always carry on, you know, his legacy. And like you said, he didn't mess with a lot of people at all. Like, he didn't rock with a lot of people. That just was his nature. Everything was a competition, and it wasn't disrespect. Well, sometimes it wasn't competition. It was just he had in his mind set out goals, and wasn't nothing or nobody going to come in between that of him reaching that goal. So that's how I look at it.